Hi, I'm Whitney Espich, the CEO of the MIT Alumni Association, and I hope you enjoy this digital production created for alumni and friends like you.
MIT and alumni and friends who are just tuning in, welcome. We're in our second of two Tech Day sessions, spotlighting four great MIT thinkers in today's program, Geniuses and Game Changers. If you missed our first speaker, note that all of these talks will be available on the MIT Tech Reunions website. You can take a look at them later. If you have questions for our speakers today, please use the Q&A feature on the live stream page, where you can also upvote others that you would like to hear answered. So just click the thumbs up icon next to your favorites. Please welcome now our second speaker, Ed Boyden, class of 99 and MEng 99. Ed is professor of biological engineering and brain and cognitive sciences at the MIT Media Lab and is the McGovern Institute Y. Eva Tan Professor of Neurotechnology. You can read Ed's full bio on the Tech Reunions website. Thank you and welcome, Ed.
Hello. Let me start my screen sharing here. The world of Zoom, right? Great. Well, it's really wonderful to talk to you today. I'm going to tell you a bit about where the science of engineering the brain is headed. I got interested in this sort of tangentially a long time ago. I was very philosophical as a kid and really wanted to understand the meaning of life. What does it mean to be human? And eventually, through a long meandering path, I ended up as an undergrad at MIT and was very interested in sciences that bordered upon philosophical and the mysterious. So I ended up studying quantum computing a bit when I was an undergrad and later a master's student. And many years later, I came back to MIT to try to set up a group that would put together engineering approaches to these mysteries of how to understand and also to repair the brain. So having trained as an engineer, one of the first things that's always interesting is, well, why is the system that we're trying to understand and fix so hard to deal with? And for the brain, I think there are two features that make it really hard to understand and fix. One is space and one is time. So what do I mean by that? Well, brain cells, neurons, are gigantic cells. They can be centimeters in spatial extent. But if you zoom in into the brain, you see these tiny connections called synapses that connect the cells. And you see these tiny biomolecules, nanometers in dimension. The human genome has, 30,000 or so genes, and all those gene products are nanoscale building blocks organized with nanoscale precision. So how can we hope to understand such a thing? And the other angle is time. If you care about learning or Alzheimer's disease or aging, these are processes that take years, even decades. But the sort of elementary building blocks of how the brain works are these millisecond timescale electrical events within neurons and these millisecond timescale chemical exchanges between neurons. So how can we understand and repair such a complex thing from nano to centimeter, from millisecond to decade? Well, the answer that we proposed was, well, we need to build tools that let us see and control the brain across these very divergent scales. If we could, maybe we could understand how the brain generates things like thoughts and feelings. And of course, there are many practical implications of this quest. We're not just here to try to understand the brain for its own sake, although I think that's very important, but there are also lots of urgent and pressing medical needs. Perhaps a billion people around the world suffer from some kind of brain condition, addiction, Alzheimer's disease, epilepsy, the list goes on and on. My own grandmother has Alzheimer's. And I think all of us, if we live long enough, will encounter one of these or a loved one will. So what can we do about it? Well, currently none of these conditions can be fully cured and the treatments are pretty partial and a lot of the treatments have side effects. And I would argue that this is because of the very same complexity that challenges us for understanding the basic operation of the brain. So today I want to tell you about two technological arenas that we've been exploring, one about space and one about time. And in both cases, I want to tell you a little bit about how we go about thinking about the problem. You know, many research groups will specialize in a specific area, like a certain kind of material or a certain kind of device or a certain kind of algorithm. But our group tries to specialize in a way of approaching problems as complex as the brain. we try to think backwards from these problems, and then we survey all these different disciplines of science and engineering, chemistry and physics, electrical engineering, computer science, and then we try to develop an invention that confronts the spatial and temporal complexity of the brain. And then we try to deploy this technology to help many people solve problems. And then finally, we take these discoveries and try to get them into the world. So let's start with space. How can we understand how brain cells are organized into these vast networks and how these tiny nanoscale molecules are organized into brain cells? Well, I think we've all seen sort of brain scans, things that look like this picture here. This is an MRI scan. And you see these blobs, or voxels as they're known, that light up. And those are an indirect measure of neural activity. They're measuring blood flow, not neural activity directly. And furthermore, these blobs or voxels are pretty large. They can contain, you know, millions or billions of brain cells. And we know from basic neuroscience that even two brain cells next to each other can be doing very different things. So of course, the advantage here is it's non-invasive, but it doesn't have the spatial precision that gets down to these building blocks. At the other extreme are microscopes. That's how brain cells were discovered in the first place over a century ago. But light has a finite size or wavelength, and you can't see things a lot smaller than that wavelength, which happens to be a few hundred nanometers, frustratingly close to where we want to be, but about 100 times too coarse to see individual nanoscale building blocks. So we started thinking backwards from this problem. How do you see across scales? And we were inspired, actually, by a physicist at MIT, Toyuichi Tanaka, who had been one of the pioneers of the study of responsive polymers, smart gels. So in this cartoon is a little animation of the kind of polymer you might find in a baby diaper. You add water, and the polymer threads, shown as little white lines, swell apart from each other as they absorb the water, an experiment that millions of kids do every day. Now, this is very practical if you want to absorb liquid in a baby diaper, and it's also been used for a lot of other interesting problems like drug delivery. But we started wondering, what if you could chemically weave this dense spiderweb-like mesh of baby diaper-like polymer throughout a brain cell or even an entire brain? Could you weave this dense spiderweb-like mesh so it went around biomolecules and between biomolecules? If you could do that just right, then when you add water, the swelling of the polymer should actually physically make the brain bigger. This is very different from how people have imaged stuff for hundreds of years, right? You zoom in with a lens and the light is magnified. But here we actually want to magnify the object itself. So that's the basic question. Can we install this polymer spiderweb-like mesh of baby diaper material around and inside cells and tissues densely and evenly? So getting to the punchline, to our surprise, actually, this is kind of a cool discovery in a way, we could do that. In panel B, in the top middle of this slide, is a small piece of the brain of a mouse, one of the most common species used in neuroscience. And in panel C on the right is the same piece of mouse brain tissue, let's say about a day and a half later, and we've physically magnified it by about 100 times in volume, about 4.5 fold in each direction. And on the left-hand side are some sketches of what the polymer might look like when it's densely winding its way around the brain cells and inside the brain cells, between the biomolecules and around the biomolecules. And the lower left is when it's swollen with water, but of course, it's pushing the brain bigger as well. Here's a little time-lapse movie that I'll show you, which hopefully will show you this an actual piece of brain growing before your very eyes. This movie sped up by about 50 fold, so the whole process takes more like an hour than a minute. And we just added the water there. So this piece of brain had the baby diaper polymer, sodium polyacrylate for the aficionados, synthesized throughout the brain earlier, and then we added water. And I hope you can see that this piece of brain tissue is growing right as you watch. So I'm sure it's only a matter of time before a Hollywood screenwriter makes a horror movie out of this. But of course, what do we want to do with it? Well, we want to understand how the brain works. Now, importantly, this expansion process is very, very even. We're turning a cell like the one on the left into a cell like the one on the right. Remember those nanoscale biomolecules I told you about? We're pulling them apart with nanoscale precision so that the biomolecules are like a constellation of stars hovering in space, but with their relative organization, meaning the biological information, preserved. That means that what we have is basically a large replica of the brain, physically much larger, but with all the biological information locked in place. So of course, this won't work on a living brain, but it will allow us to magnify preserved tissues. And so here's a piece of the brain of a mouse that's involved with, amongst other processes, memories. These cells are expressing different fluorescent proteins. These are proteins from jellyfish and coral and other critters that glow. And we expanded this piece of brain tissue. And I hope you can see here is we can actually see the fine wires of the brain, those nanoscale conduits of electricity that I mentioned earlier. So our hope is someday, maybe in the coming years, we could be able to make maps of the brain so detailed that we could actually try to look at the circuitry. How is information flowing and being transformed by the brain? Could you someday have a map of the brain so detailed that you could try to simulate things like decisions and feelings? Now, as I mentioned earlier, we also try to deploy these inventions and help people use them. And so one of the things that people talked to us about was about detecting diseases early. How do you do that? Well, early in a disease, the changes are really subtle. And so what we realized is that if we physically magnified a tissue like this breast cancer biopsy you see in the movie here, in the image here, maybe we could take those tiny invisible changes and make them large and obvious. And so we collaborated with a bunch of doctors from different institutions and found that we could actually do early disease detection. We could take a piece of tissue from a human patient, magnify it, and turn the early invisible changes of a disease into big obvious ones. So that gives you an example of how we are inventing, we're making discoveries, and then we are designing and deploying these into the world. So that's short stories about space. Now I want to tell you one short story about time. As mentioned earlier, brain cells use these high-speed electrical events to compute. How can we actually understand them? Well, one idea is, what if you could control individual brain cells? Now, there are many ways to do that. You can use electricity, for example, or you could try to use pharmacology, but those are not very precise. And so we started wondering, could you actually control brain cells with light? How would you do that? Well, suppose you could install a little solar panel in a brain cell. The solar panels convert light to electricity. The brain cells compute using electricity. We could then control brain cells with light. Now, you can also get light into the brain. The brain doesn't feel pain, so you can bring light in with an optical fiber. If you could do this, you could turn brain cells on or off and see what they do. Then the question became, how do you make those little tiny solar panels? It turns out that all over the tree of life, you can find organisms like this single cell green algae that contain photoreceptors, molecules that convert light into electrical signals. So green algae swim around in bodies of water, and we can actually take a small protein called an opsin, which converts light into electrical signals. And these are found in a tiny part of the algae called an eye spot. This small molecule converts light into electrical signals. And here's where we got lucky. A lot of serendipity plays a role in neuroscience. And here we got really lucky that this is a protein encoded for by a small snippet of DNA. So what does that mean? Well, it means you can take the small snippet of DNA, transplant it into a gene therapy vector or a virus. And of course, gene therapies are actually already in use in humans. So this is something where we can build off of a different field. We can take that small snippet of DNA, put it into a gene therapy vector or a virus, much like the kind that are approved for use in humans, and deliver that gene therapy vector into a living brain. So this is all currently being used to study the brain in animals, although a few people are doing human trials for conditions like blindness, although the data is still being collected. Anyway, we got really, really lucky here. Brain cells, we found, would take up these viruses and manufacture these proteins from algae and other small critters. And amazingly, this is just sheer dumb luck. When we shine light on the brain cells, those proteins would allow light to be converted into those tiny electrical signals. And we could then actually activate cells in the brain and make them do what we want. So this is very cool, right? We can activate brain cells and drive them and have them trigger changes in the brain. And we can see whether those changes could trigger a behavior or a computation, or maybe whether you could actually drive a pattern of activity that could overcome a brain disease condition. So one thing we did, of course, as I mentioned, is we invent a tool and then we deploy it to many people and help them use it. And Li Wei Sai's group at MIT used this tool to activate one kind of cell in the brain, these little star-shaped cells called interneurons. If you put this molecule from algae into the interneurons using a gene therapy vector that's carefully designed, then when you shine light, blue light in this case, it'll activate just those cells and not their neighbors. Their group went on to make a really stunning discovery. They used mice that are engineered to develop Alzheimer's-like symptoms. And they found that if you activate these brain cells at a special frequency, 40 times a second, these brains actually got better. They would clean up the molecular pathology of Alzheimer's. And this is really incredible, right? Because Alzheimer's, again, is one of those diseases for which we have no cure and really no treatments that can stop the disease. The teams went on under Li Wei's leadership to also find that you could deliver this brainwave, this special frequency pattern, without using our technology. So they used our technology to make the initial discovery, but went on to show that you could use just our eyes and ears to deliver these brainwave patterns into the brain. So they took these mice that have Alzheimer's-like symptoms, and they would just expose them to a flickering light or a clicking sound, and these animals would get better. So we're actually are now doing human trials of flickering lights and clicking sounds with actual Alzheimer's patients. So I'm giving you two examples today, one about space and one about time, about how we try to invent new tools that get to fundamental scientific insights about how the brain works. We then help people make discoveries about how the brain works or can be repaired. And then we try to help design practical implementations that can get out into the world, whether it's for early detection of cancer or in the project that Li Wei is leading, ways to potentially treat Alzheimer's disease. And I think that really illustrates a take-home message here, which is when you have a problem as complex as the brain, whether it's understanding or repairing it, you need to bring together every part of the sciences and engineering disciplines to confront it. And this slide is really dense and too many people listed on it to help to read out loud. But I just wanted to end on this note that you hear a lot about interdisciplinary research right now, bringing two fields together. Neurotechnology is becoming an omnidisciplinary science. We need every part of the sciences and engineering disciplines to work together if we really want to understand and repair the brain. So stay in touch. We're very excited to always learn about new problems to work on and help people use tools to solve them.
Thanks for joining us. And for more information on how to connect with the MIT Alumni Association, please visit our website.